Including a lecture on Ashabul Kahf. And therefore, today we are going to concentrate on three things. Number one is that we are going to concentrate on verses number 25 and 26, which is related to this event. Second thing we are going to concentrate is what are the lessons that we can take from this incident. And finally, what is the aim of the Holy Quran to mention these events? One of these events, of course, is about the companion of the caves, companions of the cave, but there are many other events of the people of the past that Allah Azza wa Jal has mentioned in the Holy Quran. So what is the general aim of mentioning these events? So to begin with, let us look at this verse. Verse number 25, Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَلَبِثُوا فِي كَهْفِهِمْ ثَلَاثَ مِئَةَ سِنِينَ وَازْدَادُوا تِسْعَ. Very interesting. Allah Azza wa Jal says, they remain in the cave for 300 years and add 9 more to that number. We may ask this question, why doesn't Allah Azza wa Jal directly say that they stayed or slept in the cave for 309 years? Why 300 years? And then Allah says, wazdadu tis'a, and add 9 more to that. Okay? There is an explanation given to that. Totally they slept for 309 years. Now, if you look at this verse of the Holy Quran, is indicating towards the solar years as well as the lunar years. Okay, why? Solar years, now this is the opinion of some of the scholars, some of the mufassirin. They say that when Allah mentions 300 years, he means their 300 years, solar years. But when he says that it is 8-9, so according to lunar calendar, it would be 309 years. How? The difference between solar and lunar calendar is 11 days. So if you were to take 11 days every year, multiply by 300, and then divide by 354, because that is the lunar year, 354, you would get something like 3.2 something something. So, 9.2 something something. So you add 9 years. And this is what some of the scholars have said, that Allah Azza wa Jal has mentioned there, that they slept for 309 years. Then following that, in verse number 26, Allah Azza wa Jal says, قُلِ اللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا لَبِثْتُمْ. In other words, Allah Azza wa Jal is saying that Allah knows best how long they remained. It is to tell the people, you go on arguing, you go on saying, 309 years, as I mentioned in one of the lectures, that some of the European historians who have written about this event, and they call them as the sleepers of the cave, not companions of the cave, but sleepers of the cave. In their story, they said they have slept 447 years. So you may argue as to how many years they slept. Allah Azza wa Jal says, قُلِ اللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا لَبِثْتُمْ. Say Allah knows best how long they remained. Now this is interesting. Look at the first word over here. I do not wish to go out of the topic, but I want to just mention. Allah Azza wa Jal is telling his messenger, قُلْ, say, if people are arguing with you and saying 309 years, 400 years, or less than that, tell them, Allahu ya'lamu bima labithtum. And if you look at this word, قُلْ, at many, many places in the Holy Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal is telling his messenger. We recite every day, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Say Allah is one. Prophet is being told, say Allah is one. Now, this is interesting. Anyone who wants to research can go into those, into that book, which gives you all the verses that begin with Qul, and you find out as to what instructions Allah Azza wa Jal has given to His Messenger. In the Holy Quran, what He has told him, what is to be said, what is not to be said. And then, this is of course, as I said, that this was now, whatever the differences were, you can have your differences, but Allah knows who is the, how long they slept. And then Allah Azza wa Jal says, لَهُ غَيْبُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. This is important. To Allah belongs the unseen of the heavens and the earth. We are staying on the earth, but we do not know what is happening where. We may not even know what is happening outside this wall just now. Allah Azza wa Jal knows everything. Whatever is happening on the earth. وَلَا رَطْبٍ وَلَا يَابِسٍ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ. There is nothing wet or dry which is not found in the clear book. Allah Azza wa Jal knows even when a leaf falls from the tree in the deepest of jungle, Allah Azza wa Jal is aware of it. لَهُ غَيْبُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَبْصِرْ بِهِ وَأَسْمِعْ. This is a beautiful sentence in Quran. Allah Azza wa Jal is telling His Messenger, how well does He see? Allah is praising Himself. How well does He see and how well does He hear? He's aware of everything. Nothing is hidden from Him. مَا لَهُمْ مِن دُونِهِ مِن وَلِيٍّ وَلَا يُشْرِكُوا فِي حُكْمِهِ أَحَدًا. They have no guardian besides Him and none shares with Him in His judgments. Right, so over here, we come to the word lahum. Lahum is a pronoun over here. If you take together ma lahum, there are some of the people who are of the opinion that the pronoun lahum belongs or is talking about the people, the dwellers of the earth and the dwellers of the heaven. While some of them say that it is an indication towards the companions of the cave. And if we look at the reason, if we look at لَهُ غَيْبُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, the verse or the part previous to this verse, you will be able to understand that this pronoun belongs to everyone. In other words, the first explanation seems to be the correct explanation. Now, we come to the lessons, and we will go through these lessons very quickly. Very important, I will try and emphasize, So, first thing is that, you will pardon today because of the screen, you may not be able to see properly, One of the lessons that we learn from here, let me put all those together, so, and then I will be able to explain. One of the lessons that we learn from the companions of the cave is, and this is very important, it relates to us. We should not be influenced and then follow blindly or imitate whatever is happening in the society. The companions of the cave, they were living in a society where there were people who were worshipping idols. That society was corrupt because that society was worshipping idols. Now, because the majority of the people were worshipping idols, so they didn't say, where the crowd goes, let us follow. No. They stood firm and they wanted to protect their faith. And in order to protect their faith, they decided that we are not going to be amongst those people who will be influenced by what is the thinking of these people, what are the actions of these people, what are the ways of their acting with the other people, we are not going to blindly imitate these people. Let me put it now into the Arabic word. We are not going to be blindly doing taqleed of these people. You're not going to follow them. This, unfortunately, is happening in our societies, where people want to follow that because the general society is doing like that, we should imitate them and follow that. My advice to myself and to you, my dear elders, brothers, and especially to the younger brothers and sisters is, your thought process should be Quranic. When you are referring any action to any action in your life, look at this, and the first picture or the first signal that comes to you is Allah pleased with this action or not? Blindly following someone because someone is doing something, or because the society is doing that way, is not right. And this is what the companions of the cave taught us. No blind following. Think, reflect, follow. Second one is hijra, migration. This is migration from polluted surroundings. The best example of this is the first migration that took place in Mecca. People did not go. At that time, immediately, they did not go to Medina. The first migration was to Abyssinia. Now, if you refer to the conversation between the people who wanted to migrate, the Muslims who wanted to migrate, and the Holy Prophet, their reasoning was, we want to go to a place where we will be able to protect our faith. They didn't say we want to go there because the business is very good there. They didn't say that we want to go there because the social life is very good there. Their argument and their purpose and their objective was that we want to go there because we want to protect our faith. So migration from the polluted surroundings. Look at these companions of the cave. According to the narrators of this event, it is said that they were ministers. If they were ministers, so they had the royal splendor. In other words, they were enjoying everything, okay? Koi taklif na hati. Everything they were enjoying, okay? They had material blessings in abundance because they were ministers. They had all that. But they rejected all that. And they stayed in a cave with all its deprivations. There were no sofa set in the cave. There were no bed to sleep on the cave. There was no food readily available there. There was no water readily available there. Nothing that was there. With all its deprivations, they were ready to leave everything which they had, all that material which they had, and migrate for the sake of only to protect their faith and not to support the oppressed or oppression and polytheism. By staying there, they did not want to give and show support that we are supporting what is happening in the society. We are supporting whatever the faith of the people is. No, they said we will leave all that and we will go and migrate. Third one is purity of food, which is, I've already mentioned before, okay? And this is that even in the most grievous circumstances, the companions of the cave taught us about the purity of food. I'm just mentioning over here that the consumption of the food that we take in our body, has a deep effect on personality, on our spirit, on our thought, on our heart. Definitely it has. What type of food you are eating, you come to realize. And If a person was to put something which is haram into his stomach and was to put polluted, then that person, and this is a barometer, or you can say a yardstick for a mu'min, for a believer, to measure as to how far he is going away from Allah Azza wa Jal. The further he goes away from Allah Azza wa Jal, know that he has got spiritual sickness in him. The same way as jealousy would destroy all our good deeds, haram food would have effect upon our iman, upon our faith. It is better to have very simple food. It is better to have food that is grown from the earth, that is the vegetables. It is better to have that simple food rather than go for, is KFC halal or not? Okay, so we come now to the next one, and the next one is about taqiyya. In that position where they were, these people did taqiyya in its educational, in its reformative, and in its constructive meaning, right? They performed, they did this taqiyya. How? And taqiyya, we know that taqiyya is not anything except that the person conceals his main subject where its divergence of facts in front of the people. If you present that, you know it is fruitless. So rather than diverge in front of the people, it is better to hide. And he protects his power for the time of struggle and striking against the enemy. Okay? Now, the next one is, in the eyes of Allah Azza wa Jal, next lesson we learn is that everyone is equal. Look at this. Those people who were there in the as companions of the cave, they were ministers. Accompanying them was a shepherd, and also accompanying them was a dog that was guarding them. In this world, they may have different ranks. This is minister. This is shepherd, this is a laborer, this person is a street sweeper. We will have that ranks. In the eyes of Allah Azza wa Jal, everyone is equal. When it comes to the ranks, in the eyes of Allah, in the path of truth, whether it is a doctor, whether it is a person who is working as a chef, whether he's a person who is driving a bus, or whether he's a person who is doing some hard labor, everyone, when they go on the path of Allah, on the true path of truth, in the eyes of Allah Azza wa Jal, everyone is equal. This was the most important lesson that attracted so many people in the early days of Islam. Bilal became equal when they migrated to Medina. He became equal with another person, another leader of Medina, because in the path of truth, we are all equal. Now, we come to one lesson which is so important for us to remember, and that is, during the time of difficulties, there is help from Allah Azza wa Jal. Who helped? When the circumstances became unfavorable, Allah made the companions of the cave go to sleep for years. This sleep was a blessing, was a help from Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah, even during that time of period of over 300 years, protected their bodies from harm. And he created an awe in them that that became their shield. If you remember the verses, Allah Azza wa Jal is telling his messenger that if you were to go into the cave and see them, you would be afraid and you would run away from there. Allah created that awe, that ru'ub in them, that people could not go near them. This is help of Allah Azza wa Jal. During time of crisis, accept your mistake. As Nabi Yunus did, what did he say? La ilaha illa ant, subhanaka, inni kuntu min al-zalimin. There is none to be worshipped except you. Glory be to you. I am amongst those who have done wrong. Quran then says, فَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمِّ. Allah Azza wa Jal then helped him and saved him from that difficulty. وَكَذَلِكَ نُنْجِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And the same way, he will also protect the believers. During time of difficulties, Allah will come to help if a person has taken the path of Allah. Youths. Who is a youth? Right? As I said at the beginning, that Allah remembers them. Fityatun. Nahnu naqussu alayka naba'ahum bilhaq. Innahum fityatun. Surely they were youths. Amanu bi rabbihim. They believed in their Lord. فَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَىٰ. And we increased their guidance. So who are these youths? Okay. If we were to look at those traditions, if you look at that event as it is mentioned, like that event which is attributed, or the narration of that event is attributed to our first Imam, Imam Ali bin Abi Talib, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. Allah. It is said that these people were ministers. So if they were ministers, they must have been of an elderly age. Right. And Quran mentions them as fitya, as youths. Right. This indicates that Quran looks at the youth or youthfulness of a person from the viewpoint of purity, from courage, and from being selfless. In other words, if there is iman, and if there is ikhlas, and if there is that enthusiasm to do, to serve the people, and to work for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, you may be having a very long white beard, but in the eyes of Allah, you are still a youth. This is Quranic view, right? So, as it is, we say, hun to budho lagu chu. Right? I'm not saying about myself. I'm saying that people will be saying, or people say, okay, you may see in appearance I'm looking old, but at heart I'm very young. Right? Now, next one is that we rely on Allah Azza wa Jal, and we always, this is one lesson which we learned last week, and that is that you should always be seeking help from His grace. And whenever you want to do any work, when you want to go and do something that is to be done tomorrow, you do not just say, I am going to do that. No. Add the sentence, inshallah. For if Allah wishes. I explained last week that one of the reasons is that Allah's power is limitless. Our power is limited. We do not know tomorrow what is going to happen. We do not even know what is going to happen the next second. But in the eyes of Allah, He knows everything. So we go on repeating this sentence. Now, it also teaches us how to confront the opponents. Now, I'm not talking about opponents. Tomorrow, dushman thai gyo, someone who has become your enemy, No, no, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a person who is an enemy of Islam, and person who is enemy of your faith. How do you confront him? It begins with that we should first of all begin with logical arguments. If you refer, take case of Nabi Musa alayhi salam. He goes to Fir'aun. He invites Fir'aun to come towards, to believe in Allah Azza wa Jal. Fir'aun refuses and he says, what is your proof? Nabi Musa presents his proof. Nabi Ibrahim does the same thing to Namrud. Other prophets did the same thing to the people when they wanted to invite them towards Allah. The first thing they did was that it was logical proofs. Give them logical proof arguments, and then the force would only be used when logical arguments were not useful to stop mischief or sedition. You do not use the force to create mischief. You do not use the force to create sedition. No, you use the force in order to stop the mischief, in order to stop the sedition. This is how you confront the opponents. The life of the Holy Prophet is a good example for us. Look at in Makkah, 13 years, logical arguments, no fight, nothing. Goes to Medina, and that mischief does not stop. And these people want to bring their thinking and their power and their superiority even into Medina. Then the Battle of Badr, then the Uhud, then Khandaq, then Khaybar, all this takes place. Logical arguments first, okay? Resurrection. And this is a very clear example for us that the resurrection is going to take place. 309 years, they are in the cave. As we have learned, and I've explained, as 6th Imam has mentioned, that twice in a year they were made to turn. Twice in a year. But that continued for 309 years. After 309 years, they all awake. Now when they are awake, what is the first question they are asking? Their first question is, how long did we sleep? They are coming now, and as if it is that we are in, we have woken up and we have slept for a day or part of day. It is only when they went there to the town to buy something is when they came to realize that we have been sleeping for a very long time. Resurrection is another lesson that we learn. And I am reminding myself and I'm reminding you, right? We know 21st March, that was the spring day, or the first day of the spring as it is called. And the Holy Prophet has reminded us, when the season of spring begins, and when you see the effects of the season of spring, at that time, remember resurrection. We will all be raised one day. Okay, we come to the final slide, and that is the third point I had mentioned, and what is the aim of the Quran in mentioning these events. The aim of this is not telling a story or telling this story as a hobby. Quran, astaghfirullah, al-ayadhu billah, is not a storybook. It mentions events. If you look at Nabi Yusuf, Allah says that it is the best story. نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنُ الْقَصَصِ. The best story. And more than 100 verses is talking about Nabi Yusuf and his life. It's not story. What it is. The aim of the Quran is to bring up some steadfast, faithful, aware, and brave men, and of course women. This is the purpose of the Holy Quran. In mentioning these events, this is the reason why Quran mentions this. It is for us to take those stories. It is for us to reflect. You can go home read these verses from Surah Al-Kahf, go through the meanings, reflect upon it, and see which lesson can you take from that story. And if we can take up that lesson and apply that lesson, we will have practiced on the teachings of the Holy Quran. And these are the samples that Allah Azza wa Jal is giving in the Holy Quran. Ashabi Kahf were not prophets, they were not even successors of the Prophet, they were not even from the family of the prophets, they were ordinary people. And their event is mentioned in the Holy Quran, simple, because they were people of faith and they did everything to protect their faith. I end up with this question: what can I and you do in order to protect our faith? Recite salawat, please. Azadaran Imam Hussain alayhi salam, hamare ghar mein kabhi ek maut ho jati hai to dil hil jata hai azadaro, aur wo bhi maut, khuda bachaye agar achanak maut ho jaye to ek martaba دل میں صدمہ ہوتا ہے, آنکھوں سے آنسو گرتے ہیں. عزاداروں, میں آپ سے کہوں, ذرا جناب زینب علیہ السلام سے پوچھئے کہ ان کا کیا حال تھا عاشور کے دن کو. ہمارا سلام ہو بی بی زینب علیہ السلام پر, اور خدا کے پاس دعا کرتا ہوں, خدایا جلد از جلد شام کا راستہ ہمارے لیے کھل جائے تاکہ ہم بی بی کے حرم کی زیارت کریں. عزاداروں, سلام ہو بی بی زینب علیہ السلام پر. شریکت الحسین ہے, اس میں کوئی شک نہیں ہے. عزاداروں, جب خبر ملی, فضا نے یا کسی نے کہا کہ اون اور محمد کام آ گئے ہیں, واہرے صبر جناب زینب علیہ السلام. ایک مرتبہ مسلح بچھایا اور دو رکعت نماز ادا کی, شکر کیا اللہ کا. آزادارو, زینب کے دل پر صدمہ تھا, جس زینب نے کبھی بھی اپنی زندگی میں چادر کے بغیر باہر نہیں نکلی تھی. عزادارو, تاریخ میں یہ بھی ملتا ہے کہ اگر رات کو بھی جناب زینب علیہ السلام کو باہر جانا تھا تو زینب علیہ السلام پردہ پوش ہو کے آگے آگے امام علی, بازو میں امام حسن اور امام حسین ہوتے تھے اور وہ جاتے تھے. عزادارو, زینب کے دل پہ کیا گزری ہوگی جب ان لعینوں نے آ کے زینب کی چادر چھین. عزاداروں, یہ تو زینب کا دل ہی سمجھتا ہے. اے زینب کے دل پہ کیا گزرا ہوگا جب زینب کو اسیر بنا کے, ہاتھوں میں رسیاں باندھ کے, کربلا سے کوفہ اور کوفہ سے شام لے گئے ہوں گے. عزاداروں, ذرا دل پہ یہ بھی سوچئے کہ زینب کے دل پہ کیا گزرا ہوگا جب کوفے میں داخلہ ہوا ہوگا. ایک زمانہ تھا زینب یہاں شہزادی کہلاتی تھی. ارے وہ بیبیاں آتی تھی زینب سے قرآن کی تفسیر سیکھنے کے لیے, آج وہی بیبیاں تماشا بن کے زینب کو دیکھنے آئی ہے. لیکن عزاداروں, زینب ماں تھی, ذرا سکینہ کے دل سے پوچھے, سکینہ کے دل پہ کیا گزری ہوگی جب گوشوارے چھینے گئے ہوگے, جب باپ کی لاش دیکھی تھی. سَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. اللهم بحق محمد وأنت المحمود, وبحق علي وأنت الأعلى, وبحق فاطمة أنت فاطر السماوات والأرضين, وبحق الحسن وأنت المحسن, وبحق الحسين وأنت قديم الإحسان، وبحق 9 المعصومين من ذرية الحسين عليهم السلام. خدایا ہماری اس قلیل عزاداری کو تیری بارگاہ میں قبول فرما. خدایا جن مرحومین کے لیے مجلس منعقد کی گئی ہے، ان اس مجلس کا ثواب ان مرحومین کے ارواحوں کو تو بخش دے. بار الہ جو جو مؤمنین اور مؤمنات بیمار ہیں ان کو شفاء عاجل اور صحت کامل عطا فرما. خدایا ہمارے گناہان کبیرہ اور صغیرہ کو معاف کرنا. خدایا جہاں جہاں بھی مؤمنین اور مؤمنات تکلیفوں اور مشکلوں میں ہیں ان کی تکلیفوں اور مشکلوں کو دور کرنا، ان کو ایمان پر باقی ثابت قدم رکھنے کی توفیق عطا فرما. خدایا علماء دین کا سایہ ہمارے سر پر باقی رکھنا. خدایا تیری حجت امام زمانہ کے ظہور میں تعجیل فرما، ان کے اصحاب اور انصار میں ہم کو شامل کرنا. وصلی اللہ علی محمد و آلہ الطاہرین. الى ارواح اموات المؤمنین والمؤمنات رحم اللہ من قرأ سورة المبارکة الفاتحہ.